So we have a chance to make a summing up panel here. I think there's lots of different threads that has been started during this last session, and I will try to somehow weave these threads together to some kind of a discussion. In Sonia's presentation, we had a lot of suggestions what radio can be. And I would like to start to think a little bit about and hook on to the discussion that we also had yesterday quite a lot about the sight and what the sight means for sound, art. And we're now in a culture hedge place, the Griveton. We saw yesterday an old windmill that was transformed and used for sound installations. And also I know that, I mean, Karsten Seifert also told us about this church that you used. And the site created specific for the art, and maybe there is also, I would like to see if radio, even if it's on the internet, or if it's a pod, if radio, if it creates a certain site that artists should explore and use, and in a similar way. Is there anybody in the board that would like to, in the panel that would like to start up with some comments on that thing? Because, for example, you, Susan, you have been working quite a lot with different sites, but also with radio. And I was thinking about when you talked earlier today, I was thinking about one of your very early pieces that you did live in a supermarket. Yeah. And used the radio system in the supermarket.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's true. That was one of my very few live works where I signed through the PA system of Tesco Metro supermarket. Melancholy pop songs that all were sung in the first person and dealt with the longing and sympathy and release. So that was interesting because I mean, to encounter the voice, you know, like that disembodied voice, you don't really usually, but you might hear it on the radio and it's with music and it's a, you know, musical accompaniment and it's it's working. And so to hear an unaccompanied voice, just clearly not trained singing voice. I think it was quite disarming for people because, you know, I'm singing these melancholy songs that are kind of pop songs, like Radiohead song, Nirvana, and these kind of songs. But there were songs that seemed to make you feel like we're eavesdropping in something quite private in this very public space. So I think what happened in that situation was people really became aware of where they were at that particular moment and who they were standing beside, and began to look around and notice the space, you know. And I think, as I said earlier when I spoke, you know, those things are really of interest to me, you know, how you can kind of draw attention to the architecture or make you see a place in a new way, you know. So, and I think with sound, with music, usually, you know, if it's mediated through the radio, or if you're seeing it in a band or something, or if you're listening to music at home, you're taken away to another place. You're not really aware of the place you're in. Whereas when you make sound interventions into public space, or, you know, with my work, I'm kind of drawing attention to the place, and so you might have a kind of simultaneous experience of being in the work, listening, being engaged, or being, and then also grounded in the present.
Would you like to say something, Chris, about that? Because also I was quite impressed by the presentation about how innovative you've been in finding possibilities in preservation and finding the financiation. There are also maybe innovative ways to use sound in this and to activate the cultural heritage.
Yes, of course. Is it too much sound? Sorry. No, yes, but before I simply say yes, I think I need to express a little bit more. I think when it comes to sectors, if I call it sectors, I don't like to call it sectors, but I do it just now. Like the cultural sector, I think that what the sector does on let's say on the society level is to see if we can get some resources for the artists. This is what I'm interested in anyway. And there is a big competition, of course, in all the negotiations for the overall budgets. So you need to find a way to express what you're doing and the effects and the impact of what you're doing, so you can attract the decision makers and policy makers to increase the budget for something. Or if you don't increase the budget for culture, maybe you can find someone to cooperate with. But if you find someone you can cooperate with, you're playing on their side, so to say, meaning that you have to express what you're doing in their way. So this is why I choose this example of job creation, because even if you don't create a single job yourself, maybe you can tell a story that of the importance of culture for job creation in general. And I think that one concept that is very important today is what's called culture capital. Because culture capital, at least as I understand it, means that we can express cultural activities not as a cost for a society, but as an investment. And all investment, you know the difference between a cost and an investment, but all investments, then the difference is that you also have a return on investment. So what I'm interested in to see how you can understand this return on investment. And we can also call it, as Pierre-Luc Sacquebel, and he say that it is a spillover effect. So what we're trying to understand is where culture participation in cultural activities has the biggest spillover effect for the economy in general. So this sensibly simple explanation is, let's say that if you are participation in culture things, art things, after a while you get used to be, you know, you get used to new impressions or expressions experience. Meaning that since you're more and more familiar with the situation, that means also that you are familiar with new things are happening around you. So these new things happening around you can be more or less new ideas, and it could be for a new organization on your office, or it could be also to be positive to you know, just an innovative idea. And this is what's happening when you go to the bank, for instance. As an investor, are you ready for this kind of new innovative idea? And I don't need to mention Steve Jobs now, when he went to the bank for the first time and said that what the world needs now is everybody needs an individual computer instead of we have this biggest one in the States. But anyway, so we try to understand what are the spillover effects for active participation in culture and how this affects what we can call regional development. And since we can do that now, we can see where it is, you know, the relation to other activities, we can also give it back to the policy and the decision makers so that they can better see how they can support regional development by supporting culture and culture activities. So this is what we're trying to do, and I think that we've done it so far. And especially now in Västra Götalands region and north here, we are having a very important and interesting cooperation with the regional policymakers now to see how they can increase the effectiveness investments in culture, and also really also increase the budget in general.
And I guess in that context also, like, these good examples like Susan's installations or work with Visit Saal and the Harp Lab is really important to see, not just in theory, mm-hmm. but also in practice, and it really works. Mm-hmm. Is there something that you would like to say?
Yeah, because there are two things that I would like to contribute. In Susan, she has complete control of the context. And in the UB Magra, we don't have any. And this is something we will work with too, because we don't know exactly the context where the listeners will consume our podcast. And this is something that our producers, they take in account too, because we know that there's people that listen to Radio UB Magra while they are ironing their trousers, or running, or going the bike to work, and this makes also in the institutional, mindset, it opens also another way of exploring how people is consuming culture, in because we are outside the site of the institution, and well, that's an idea I would like to point. And in the other hand. Back in 2006, the beginning of the project, one of the things that we had on the table was that this idea of returning the cultural capital to society, because there were a lot of curators, artists that were visiting the museum because they were preparing any project or something, and there was a lot of transparency in their meetings and so on, and constantly we saw how interesting ideas or interesting parts of the process of producing finally an exhibition or a public program were something we wanted to share with the audience. And this idea of capturing with audio and little interviews and things that were happening during the process of something that that finally would end up in an event or an exhibition was something that we also had on the table at the beginning. So, well, in one way or the other, I feel related with what you just already said.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking a little bit also when I'm completely changing the subject. When we were driving here, we heard that old folk song. And I was starting to think a little bit about preservation of sound. How can sound be preserved, and how can actually the radio broadcast be a part of heritage? Because the building is one thing and all the equipment here, but the content is also important. And you've been working with this also, like not finding these old folk songs and reviving them in some way. In your research has been very important for you to find this kind of material.
Yeah, absolutely.
For me, the finding songs is a bit like finding found objects or something, and I love that they have this history, that they've had a life before, and I'm singing them again, well, more in the case of the pop songs, where they do become like folk songs. People say to me, "So was that an old Scottish ballad you were singing, Susan?" I say, "No, it was Radiohead." But I think when it's only the voice, which often folk songs are, they become like they could be, they're kind of timeless, But yeah.
I know also next to
the Bonjus Constant that you worked with quite soon. There is an archive for folk songs. I'm sure they told you about that.
Well, the library upstairs, it's really fascinating. So they thought I might be interested in that, and I am, for sure. But yeah, I'm trying to think of songs in the radio. Yeah, I don't know. I might hand it over to you and come back to talk about folk songs.
Preservation of sound, yeah. Collecting. I was also thinking of collecting and how to collect in
yeah,
the institution.
Yeah, this is an issue for us, of course. First of all, about the format and how do we store the format uncompressed and the different compressions we produce later on. Fortunately, we have the Magma Archive, who has the resources to do that, because the website is a way to present the content, but obviously you cannot rely on a web server to preserve, regular hosting web server to preserve any archive material or any heritage material in that sense, we know we should, we rely on our colleagues in the archive that they tell us what new specifications we should provide to preserve it, but finally we store archives, digital archives. And I don't know if in that sense storing audio digital archives it's very different than storing image digital archives. I mean that the problems or the issues, it's how do you preserve digital in general, which is something that we cannot assure in a long term, how will it work? This opens a very tricky way for this panel. I mean, it's something very controversial and, scary, I think.
I mean, it's true, I'm in archives a lot, sourcing material, it's true. I mean, some of them. And more recently, I've been doing this war-damaged musical instruments ongoing project where I've been recording these instruments that might have not been played for over 100 years, but they're in these archives, and they're in boxes in the dark, and they haven't been out of their boxes for like I say 100 years. So that's been fascinating to actually get access to these incredible old archives where you get all sheet music and books and those kind of things, but it's interesting now for me as an artist who primarily works with sound, how do you preserve the sound, because the medium changes all the time, and what is the format that you hand over to the collector or the museum, so at the moment it's USB sticks, but they're just so small and they don't look like anything, so. How do you make it, put in a nice presentation of it?
I'm sure Krista has some comments as well.
Yeah, I hope so. But I don't remember the first question now. But anyway. Now, if you go to the intangible heritage, I mean, when you speak about cultural heritage, you often speak about the tangible, which is the structures, and intangible, of course, is the, for instance, the folk songs. And so on. And today we also speak about a third level, so to say, which is the digital heritage, what you can do with that. So, but I think, of course, it's of great importance to see how you can, let's say, use this kind of heritage. And today, I think one of the important things is to see how we can increase what we call the social cohesion, or whatever we call it, and see how groups of people can work together in that way. So, and then taking a step from that, we speak about democracy in general, actually. And we can also see that both the intangible heritage is a source of struggle, you know, also conflicts and even wars. So I just came back from Palestine, and where you can see that it's the fight of both the tangible heritage, who does it belong to, and who can claim it's our or my heritage, or also the intangible, which is the folk songs, for instance, could also be a struggle against. So it's, of course, it's also the sources for democracy. But and also when you look upon the newspaper, even today, you can see there's, UNESCO said something about what's happening in Iraq when they're destroying the heritage. And we also have this discussion, at least in Scandinavia, for freedom of speech. I mean, also the borderline success from what an artist can express, and also freedom of speech, and also what's happening if you're too active on the internet. I mean, you can have all these guys saying whatever they said to you. So of course, all of these things are putting also heritage and culture into the new situation. But it is very important to see, I think, one more time, this let's call it the intangible spillover effects, what's happening. So, and maybe the strongest word here is social cohesion.
Would like also to give you in the audience a chance to pose any questions to the panel, or any comments on the topic of radio art and heritage, collecting, and there is archiving. There's a lot of knowledge, Morten. Not know if the microphone is reaching the way.
Thank you. I just wanted to share with you the experience we had in Denmark of creating this research infrastructure for actual radio archives called LARM, noise. And maybe that could be something that could be a good thing to tap into in the attempt also to do the same thing this week. I mean, the general thing was to actually come together with the universities, Danish broadcast company, a couple of museums, and also with a focus on private and small archives, because I think that radio is mostly listened to in the private homes. So one of my focus points has been to discover methodologies to actually enter into those private archives of listening material and recording material. But of course, the big archives is mostly the center stage of what we are discussing here, I guess, how to bring that into our cultural attention, so to speak. And that was the purpose of LARM, to create that kind of national research infrastructure. I'm not sure it actually succeeded, but the questions that came out of that attempt are as important as the results, which right now is kind of an online service called Chaos. not because it is Chaos, but that's the name of the database. I can tell you more about it if you're interested.
So any other comments now? In the last minutes of this conference? If not, is there any in the panel who wants to say something more? Otherwise, I would like to thank you all for a wonderful days here, both in Halmstad and here at Grimmelkom. It's been fantastic. Arranged by Anna and Lodjana and everybody else that has worked with you participants in the panels and in all the lecturings and workshops, and of course you in the audience as well. So thank you, everybody.
Side too, from Hammans Kunstmuseum, Region Halland, Riksutställningen. It's been really inspiring to hear all the talks, and thank you for being patient with the tight schedule, and yeah, I hope you've enjoyed the 2 days. We will now go on with the last part, which is a guided tour in like 20, it will take like 20 minutes, I think. And then there is the bus waits for us outside where it stopped.
Thank you.
So thank you.